by his word, prayer. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you, God, for just your faithfulness in watching over us last night, for not allowing, oh God, judgment to prevail over us, for your grace and your mercy. Despite all things, you are still worthy of all of our praise. This is not a solicitation, God, for wants, just a simple request, God, that you would have your way in, through, and with us. We come before you with so many wants, never really considering what it is that you would have of us. So God, do what you choose to do in all of our lives, oh God, and that you might be glorified in all things. For God, we want to give you glory. We want our lives to bring you glory. Help us now, God, to give you the very best of what we have. The best praise, the best hallelujah, the best thank you, Jesus, because truly you have been just that good to us. And for this, God, we are just so thankful, grateful, appreciative of all that you do, but certainly, God, all that you've already done. So if you don't do anything else, God, as the songwriter said, you've done more, done enough. If you don't bless me one more time, God, you're still done. You've done more than enough. For many of us, our testimony could be as well it should be. When we look back over our lives and see all of the things that you have done, where you brought us from, how you kept us, how you made ways for us, how you've been a bridge for us over troubled waters, shelter at a time of storm, our leaning post, bread when we were hungry, water when we were thirsty, doctor in the sick room, lawyer in the courtroom. Certainly, God, we could just keep writing on and on and on about your greatness, about your goodness. And so, God, when we consider all of these things, we can't help but give your name praise and say thank you. Thank you, Father, for just being so faithful to us. And God, we just want, God, you to be glorified in, through, and with us. Nothing about wants, but we ask God that you would grow us. And I realize, God, that's a challenging thing for all of us. But God, help us to grow more in you. Through the providential care of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, God, in whom is hidden all of the wonderful treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Help us, God, to become more transformed into his image. God, that we may, oh God, look more like you. We thank you right now. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Now, God, we pause that we might hear a word from you. Speak to us as only you can. And we be ever so careful to declare like the hymnologist, bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Hush our hearts, still all of our suspicions about one thing or another. And then, God, in the words of the saints of old, breathe on us, O breath of God, fill us with life anew, that we may love like thou dost love and do as thou would do. The words of our mouth, meditation of our heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Join me in saying amen, amen, and amen. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. You know it's wild, on earth thus thou art called. Calling to Savior, why don't you hear my humble cry? Oh, you know it's why on earth thus thou art calling. Do not pass me find a sweet relief. I'll be kneeling there in deep contrition. Lord, I need you to my unbelief. I'm calling you Savior. Oh Lord, Savior, why don't you hear my humble thus thou art calling, Savior, do not pass me by. I'm calling you, Savior, oh Lord, Savior. Thus thou art calling, Savior, do not pass me by. Amen. God bless you. And may the word of God be a blessing to you on this first Sunday morning in the month of August. God is truly worthy of all of our praise. He has kept us, no doubt, and allowed us this wonderful privilege of seeing yet another day. I want to draw your attention, if you will. Join us in the book of James. This time we'll be in James chapter 5. This is the part 2 of our series on the key to victory in prayer. James chapter 5, verses 13 through 18. For those of you that have your Bibles and those of you that have your, perhaps, devices that you can follow along, I'll be reading from the King James Version, the word of God for the people of God. Notice James's words. He says, "Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he has committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elias, meaning Elijah, was a man subject to like passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Thus said in the reading of God's word for God's people, God's word is no doubt a blessed word. In the words of Paul, the Apostle Paul, Galatians chapter 2 and verse 24, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ who lives in me, and the life that I live now, I live not by myself, but by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me so much that he gave his life for me. Again, this is part two of our series on the key to victory in prayer. Let me begin by making it clear to all who are listening that there is absolutely no limit to the potential of what James is talking about here in our text, and that is prayer. Of all the things a believer can learn to do in this life, the most important is learning to pray. In fact, if we know prayer must be important, or we know rather that prayer must be important, because from the very beginning of time, and you can go back to Genesis chapter 4 and verse 26, it shows us that men have always prayed in all types of places, at all times, and in every conceivable situation, men have often prayed. People from every walk of life, whether saved or unsaved, have spent massive amounts of time in the pursuit of prayer. But few people have made prayer their supreme priority. Those who have done so stand out as bright lights in a dark world. Many have chosen to pray when it was just simply the convenient thing to do, or when they were going through a time of perhaps great stress, great trials in their life. But despite all of these things, it's clear from the reading of Luke chapter 18 and verse 1 that Jesus wanted prayer to hold a preeminent place in all of our lives, right? Because as Jesus tells it, God expects us to be constant in our prayers, because in being constant in our prayer, we are also at the same time in contact with him. Before we get ahead of ourselves, I think it's important for us to understand exactly what prayer really is, and because knowing what prayer is will help us to see that it deserves an elevated place in each of our lives. To begin, Mark chapter 5 and verses 22 and 23, in the occasion of Jairus, teaches that prayer is an invitation to God. It's not coercion. Prayer is not coaxing, but simply inviting God to take over. It's me admitting my weakness and his power. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 41 and 42, regarding the cities of refuge, teaches that prayer is really some hard work. True praying is not for lazy people. You see, true prayer may require that you get up early in the morning, or perhaps stay up late in the midnight hour. A prayer is never really finished until it has grown feet and gone to work. Prayer is also a battle, because Satan does not fear, nor does he withstand our prayerlessness, but he will bitterly oppose our prayer efforts. Prayer is our greatest weapon in the battle between good and evil. And when we consider Moses, Daniel, the three Hebrew boys, Elijah, Paul, and Silas, who had been locked in prison, their experience proved that prayer is no doubt power. Prayer is the greatest power that you and I have here on this earth. Prayer is also a developer. It is the essential ingredient that completes our character. Prayer is a developer because it's always a thing that we must remember as impossible to grow in grace without the aid of prayer. Prayer is also the believer's wardrobe. We dwell in a cold world, but that does not mean that the child of God who prays need never fear becoming gold, and the praying church will never become a museum of frozen saints. Prayer is also the fragrance in Christian activity. It's better than artificial flowers. True prayer envelops all that we do in the breath of heaven. And then finally, brothers and sisters, prayer is communication with heaven. There is an unbroken line between earth and the Father. But when you and I pray, we are brought all the way into his presence and in touch with God himself. It's for these reasons that prayer must be our priority. This theme is repeated throughout the Bible. We've already shared what Jesus says in Luke chapter 18 and verse 1, but the Apostle Paul also gives us the same point in Romans 12 and 12. Paul says, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. The point here is that when it comes to prayer, we ought to remain in a constant spirit of prayer. Job, Abraham, and Moses are men who place a high priority on prayer. And they're not alone. In fact, the Psalms are filled with many references to David's prayer life. We can see that in 2 Samuel chapter 12, where David fasted, prayed, and wept for his child. Prayer was the secret of David's fearlessness. Prayer caused the words of a man by the name of Samuel to never fall void to the ground, because he was, by all accounts, a man of prayer. Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 1 was a man who had prayed that there would be no rain in the land, and it did not rain for 3.5 years. And in chapter 18, when Elijah's 64-word prayer is prayed, it caused fire to fall from heaven. Daniel in Daniel chapter 6 prayed and fasted for 3 weeks to get an answer to just one prayer. Jeremiah learned to pray for great and mighty things from God. And let us not forget our Lord Jesus Christ. He relied on prayer. Matthew 14 and 23, Matthew 26 and 36, Mark 1 and verse 35, and Luke chapter 6, chapter 9 and verse 29. These are just a few scriptures, but if the Son of God had to pray, how much more people like us? When we look at Matthew chapter 6 and verse 5, it becomes clear to us who believe that Jesus somehow takes it for granted that his people are going to pray. Did I mention that prayer ought to be? Prayer actually should be a priority in all of our lives. And if I didn't, then let me just make it clear that prayer should be not just a priority, but prayer should be top priority in all of our lives, because it's our lifeline to the Father. That means that prayer is something that should always be practiced. This great pianist by the name of Rubinstein was once asked about his piano practice, and he replied, "If I miss practice one day, I know it. If I miss practice 2 days, my friends will know it. If I miss practice for 3 days, the whole world will know it." The same applies to the child of God when it comes to prayer. And I don't mean to burst your bubble this morning, but it isn't enough to just know prayer formulas or rules and promises relating to prayer. To make prayer the effective weapon that God intended prayer to be, you and I, as God's children, just like Rubinstein, this great pianist, and so many who are good in their craft, must practice. And our practice is with prayer. We have to get ourselves busy, brothers and sisters, in the business of prayer. There are too many needs and too many of little time that we have left. As Ian Bounds said it, to be little with God is to be little for God. When we are not in the custom of praying, that's the time that we may need to pray desperately, even when we may not know how to pray. But remember this, brothers and sisters, weak praying begets weak living. But on the other hand, strong praying begets strong living. We must be diligent in our praying if we want to be effective for our God. If not, we will soon show up in our powerless Christian living. So make sure that you visit your prayer closet often. Notice the words to the poem, The Secret. The poet writes, I met God in the morning when my day was at its best, and his presence came like sunrise, like a glory in my breast. All day long, the presence lingered. All day long, he stayed with me, and we sailed in perfect calmness over a very troubled sea. Other ships were blown and battered. Other ships were sore distressed, but the winds that seemed to drive them brought us to a peace and rest. Then I thought of other mornings with a keen remorse of mine, when I too had loosed the moorings with the presence left behind. So I think I know the secret. Learn from many a troubled way. You must seek him in the morning if you want him through your day. Then I mentioned that you need to make sure that you visit your prayer closet often. The key to victory in prayer is our understanding of what the scriptures teach regarding his house as well as his people. According to the scripture, Isaiah 56 and 7 tells us that the Lord's house is to be a house of prayer. Even then will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar, for mine house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. That's the Lord's house. It's the house of prayer. And then in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 17, the Apostle Paul says, God's people are also to be a people of prayer. I heard him say, pray without ceasing. Romans 12 and 12 says, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Ephesians chapter 6 and 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplications for all the saints. You see, we are told to pray. We are taught to pray. We need to pray. And more importantly, we must pray. But as necessary as prayer is in the life of the believer, it saddens me to say that prayer and the prayer meeting have become the stepchildren of the church. And it's for this reason that God's people need some fresh insight into the awesome power of prayer and the great necessity of our hour, and that is prayer. I don't know about you, but I'm ready to see God touch this world. I'm ready to see God touch our community by his power. And the only way that's going to happen is when those of us who are saved get serious about praying and learn to call on the name of the Lord more than just when we want something. There will never be a great move of God in this world, in this city, not even our community or any congregation for that matter, until God's people first learn to take prayer more seriously. So as the Spirit gives strength and liberty this morning, I would just like to use these few minutes that you and I have to look into these verses and see what James is trying to teach us about the key to victory in prayer in this part two. First and foremost, I want you to notice that we are challenged to pray. That's right, challenged to pray. It's right there in verses 13 through 16, the A part of that text. James is speaking primarily about prayer and healing of the sin sick believer, but he also gives us some insight into our own daily prayer life. The challenge set before every true child of God in these verses is to pray. As a matter of fact, we should do nothing in any area of our lives without first taking the time to saturate whatever it is we're taking to God in prayer. Even Jesus preceded all of his activities with prayer. He did so before the feeding of the 5,000. He did so before raising Lazarus up from the dead. He did so before his trial and his crucifixion. He did so before becoming the sin on the cross for you and for me. Prayer is important, especially in the realm of spiritual activity. We are doomed to failure when we attempt to perform spiritual efforts in the power of our flesh. We only succeed and God gets the glory when you and I carry out his work in the power of prayer. That's what happened in the story of a young Presbyterian preacher by the name of Dr. J. Wilbur Chapman and his prayer warriors. At the age of 26, he was called to pastor Wanamaker's Church in the city of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. His first Sunday, an old gentleman came up to him and said, "You're much too young to be the pastor of such a fine church as this." Dr. Chapman thought the old man was a little bit loose in the head somewhere, but the old gentleman went on to tell him that he had decided that he was going to pray for him, that the Holy Spirit's power would fall on him each time he stepped into the pulpit. And so he did. He and another man would pray with him. And in telling the story, Dr. Chapman reports that those two men soon turned into 10, then 20, then 50, and finally more than 200 men would gather each Sunday morning before services and pray for the Holy Spirit's enablement. Over the next 3 years, the church saw 1,100 people come into the kingdom, and more than 600 of those people were men. Brothers and sisters, I've learned that the preparation gained in the closet of secret prayer is far more valuable than that gained in our studies. It's in our prayer closets that preparations are made for a whole lot of things that James says you and I must pray for. Things like affliction. To be afflicted means to endure hardship. Those who are at least walking through the valleys and the trials of life are to be careful for nothing but in everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving in our hearts, we must let our requests be made known unto God. We are to pray in preparation for afflictions. And then also, we are to pray in preparation for sickness. And here's why, because God is a healer. So when you and I, or even perhaps others are sick, we are to go to God in prayer on behalf of those who are afflicted with sickness. We are to pray in preparation for afflictions, for sickness, and also for the brethren, meaning our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are to be in prayer one for another in the family of God. We have a duty to one another to pray, according to Scripture, fervently about the needs, the burdens, and the lives of our fellow believers. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 2. It says there, "Bear ye one another's burdens." That's the command from Scripture. "And so fulfill the law of Christ." We are to pray in preparation of afflictions, in preparation of sickness, in preparation of our brothers and sisters in Christ. And believe it or not, we are also to pray in preparation of joy. It is implied here that when there is joy, that should also be expressed. And what better place to express your joy, this joy that you have, than being before the Lord in prayer? That's what Ephesians chapter 5 tells us there in verse 20. "Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father
in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's God's will in Christ Jesus concerning what we read in 1 Thessalonians 5 and 18. Christians can and should also always pray for these things. The challenge here has to do with what James makes mention of in verse 15, the strength of our power, the strength of our prayer, rather. In verse 15, James mentions the prayer of faith. And Bible says he mentions the prayer of faith because faith is what gives prayer its strength and effectiveness. God does answer prayer, but he does so in response to the faith of his people who pray. Matthew chapter 21 and 22, and in all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, notice that, believing, you shall receive. Since the beginning of chapter 1 and verses 5 through 8, James makes it clear that faith is an essential ingredient in effective praying. When Hudson Taylor went to China, he made the voyage on a sailing ship. As it neared the channel between the southern Malay Peninsula and the island of Sumatra, the missionary heard an urgent knock on his storeroom or stateroom door. He opened it, and there stood the captain of the ship. "Mr. Taylor," he said, "we have no wind. We are drifting toward an island where the people there are heathen, and I fear they are cannibals. What can I do?" asked Taylor. "I understand that you believe in God. I want you to pray for wind." "All right, Captain, I will, but you must be the one to set the sail." "Why, that's ridiculous. There's not even the slightest breeze. Besides, the sailors will no doubt think that I'm crazy." Nevertheless, the captain finally agreed. And then 45 minutes later, he returned and found that missionary still on his knees, praying. He said to him, "You can stop praying now. We've got more wind than we know what to do with. Whatever you need from God, it must be asked for in faith." God doesn't simply respond to our asking. It's our faith in what God says that moves God into action. There's the strength of power in verse 15. And then there's also the source of our prayer. And it's right there. Make no mistake about it. You got to understand that all prevailing prayer has really its roots in the written word of God. That simply means that you shouldn't pray for something that is frivolous and then expect God to grant you your wish. But when God has specifically spoken to something in his word, that's when you and I can pray with absolute confidence, knowing it's God's will. And because it's God's will, God will answer our prayer. Faith is always based on the word of God. That's what Paul is speaking of in Romans chapter 10 and verse 17. "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." In other words, if there's a need, God will need it. If there's fear, God will replace it. If there's a burden, God will lifted. If there's a need for someone to be saved, God will save them. If there's a sin to be forgiven, God will forgive it. All I'm trying to say is that when we pray, we can only pray in faith. If we can base our prayers on the revealed will of God, on his word as found in the Bible, God will no doubt do it. Anything else is just merely about our own wants, about our own desires and our own griefs. Often these things are not wrong, and God may very well grant you these things. But we can have absolute assurance that he will always answer those prayers that are prayed as a result of his own promise. But unfortunately, sometimes an answer to prayer can be anything but a blessing. Let me run that by you one more time. Sometimes an answer to prayer can be anything but a blessing. Years ago, a pastor was called to the home of a widow whose teenage daughter was the apple of her eye. She mentioned that at the age of 3, her daughter was very ill, and the doctors had already told her that her daughter would die. No doubt this mother shocked was shocked, but we can't justify her action. She admitted that she had accused God of cruelty. She had commanded that the Lord spare her daughter. As a matter of fact, she told God that she could never trust him again if he did not do as she had asked. Well, God, being who God is, granted her requests in spite of what the doctors had said. The child grew up and lived a normal life for 13 years. But then she caught hold of some bad company. At the age of 17, she got into real trouble and broke her mother's heart. The tragic end of the story was told by this weeping mother when the same pastor arrived at her home that day. She said to him, "My Janie is dead. She took her own life last night. And I found her in her room bright early this morning." After several minutes of convulsive sobbing, this weeping mother had concluded in front of this preacher, "Oh, how I wish God had taken her when she was 3 years old. How I wish I had not insisted on having my own way." Can I tell you again that sometimes an answer to our prayer is anything but a blessing? The key to victory in prayer has to do with the fact that the text teaches we are challenged to pray, but when you pray, pray the prayer of faith, meaning according to the Lord's will. In the B part of verse 16, I want you to also be able to see that the key to victory in our prayer has to do with our frame of mind in prayer. Our frame of mind in prayer. Here in this B part of verse 16, I want you to notice that it has to do with the types of, or perhaps the kinds of, prayers to pray. James says that our praying is to be effectual fervent. These two words are the translation of a word that means to display one's activity. In other words, to put forth power. I wish I had some help right about here. And I wish I had my Bible study student. In other words, you ought to put something in it. Give God the very best that you have, even when you pray. It simply means that we ought to pray in faith and then put legs on our prayers for God's glory. You see, the pattern is, when it comes to prayer and us praying, we tend to ask God, and then we sit down and we wait on God. But you see, God's plan is that we ask, then we thank him for the answer that we know is coming, and then we get up and live as though prayer has already been answered. Let me run that by you again just one more time. When we pray, we tend to just ask, and then we sit. And we wait. No matter how long we wait, we just sit there doing nothing. But how many of you know the Lord's plan? God's plan is that, number one, we ask him. Number two, we thank him for the answer that we know is coming according to his word. And then number three, we just simply get up and live our lives as though the prayer that we pray has already been answered. Can somebody help me to say it's already done? Because God's word has already promised that he would. He might not come when you want him to come, but God knows he'll show up on time. Many years ago in Bristol, England, George Mueller operated what is called an orphanage for 2,000 children. One evening, he became aware that there would be no breakfast for these children the next morning. So he called all of his workers together and he explained to them the situation. Two or three had prayed, and now that's a sufficient thing, he said. No need for long prayer. He said, we just need to touch and agree that God will somehow show up. So let's rise and praise God for the answer. The next morning, they could not push open the large doors to the front, so they went out the back door and around the building to see what it was that were keeping the door from being shut, or keeping the door shut, rather. As they got there, stacked up against the front door were a whole lot of boxes filled with food. One of the workers could be heard saying, "We know who sent the baskets, but what we don't know is who brought them." I wish I had somebody to help me here. That ought to encourage us to be always fervent in our prayers. In other words, we ought to be excited about praying, knowing that when we pray, God will answer. We should pray with a zeal for souls, a burning in our hearts. Prayer should never be a humdrum of an undertaking. Not only does the frame of mind have to do with the type of, or perhaps even the kind of prayers to pray, but James makes it clear that it has everything to do with the type or kind of person who prays. James calls it the effectual prayer, oh yes, a righteous man. Don't miss that. He calls effectual prayer a righteous man. This refers to a standard of life that reflects a commitment to God and his word and his will. To put it in a way that you understand, God has respect for the prayers of the holy. However, now, as much as we wish that he would, God does not hear the prayer of the sinful. Let me prove it to you. Let me prove it to you, because I know you're having a hard time with that. Let me prove it to you. I want to use Psalm 66 and verse 18. Notice what David said. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. 1 John 3 and 22. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. John 15 and verse 7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Listen, brothers and sisters, if we are determined to be effective in prayer, we will have to get our lives lined up with God and his will for our lives. Mark it down. The type or kind of prayer to pray and the type or kind of person who prays has a lot to do with the type of power displayed in your prayer. I'll say that again. The type or kind of prayer to pray and the type or kind of person who prays has a lot to do, and I would venture to say that it has everything to do with the type of power that's displayed in your prayer life. James tells us that proper and God-honoring prayer is the very thing that availeth much. Proper and God-honoring prayer is the very thing that availeth much. That simply means to put forth much more than what was expected. Y'all don't hear me? When we pray in faith, it unlocks the great potential of God to work in our world and on our behalf. God honors the praying of his people because his people praying honors him. Missionary finally in Africa years ago had two small little children. Second being born after they arrived on the mission field. The youngest was the one who was sickly and needed much more care. Had to be wrapped in blankets most of the time to ensure that the child stayed warm enough. The mother was heard to say over and over again, I wish we had a hot water bottle. Her thinking was that with a hot water bottle, she could place it next to the child and provide it some heat. And after a few weeks, a package arrived all the way from England. And in that package were several items that had been sent to the family anonymously to help them in their new location. Among the items, there was a hot water bottle. The mother thanked God for what she had received, but she could not recall having prayed for it. As the last of the items were taken out of the box, the oldest child came forth to ask her mother, where's my new baby doll? Her mother responded, there's no doll in here. The little girl asked them to just look again, and when they did, under all the packing materials that was in the box was just a little new baby doll. The mother asked the girl how she knew there was a doll in there. The little girl said, well, when I asked God to send a hot water bottle for the baby, I also asked him to send me a baby doll. Brothers and sisters, the story becomes even more remarkable when we stop to consider that this package had to travel all the way to Africa, first by ship, then by packing it on top of animals until it reached where the family was. It began its journey 6 months before the baby pray for those things. Can I tell you this morning, what a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. The key to victory in prayer has to do with the fact that we are challenged to pray. And brothers and sisters, you and I will always be challenged to pray. For as Jesus told Peter, Satan desires to sift you like wheat. You might as well pray, because things will no doubt come your way that will shake the very foundation of your faith. So pray that God will strengthen you, that God will help you to get through those difficult times. Not only are we challenged to pray, but it has everything to do with our frame of mind, according to the B part of verse 16. And then finally here in verses 17 and 18, we see that the key to victory in all of our prayer life has everything to do with our confidence in prayer. Our confidence in prayer. It's important to remember that God promises in prayer that he will to hear us and he will help us. To hear us, that's the promise of his word in Jeremiah 33 and 3, where he says, call unto me and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou hast not known before. Not only does God promise in prayer to hear us, but God also promises in prayer that he will help us. God helps when we ask for help. Matthew 7 and verse 7 and 8, ask, and it shall be given unto you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and the doors shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receive it, and he that seeketh, findeth, and to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. Mark chapter 11 and verse 24, whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe that you will receive them, and you shall have them. Our confidence in prayer has everything to do with what James describes here in our text as God's performance in prayer. We are confident because of God's performance in the past. When I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, that's confidence in what God has already done for me in times past. What he did yesterday, what he did last week, what he did last month, last year. You can have confidence in God's performance in prayer. We have a God who Paul in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20 says is able to do exceeding abundantly above everything that you and I can ask or even think of. And what James tells us about Elijah here in our text is that God moved in response to Elijah's prayer of faith. God doesn't always answer prayers to our liking or really on our timetable, but he does answer the prayers of his children. This truth is seen in these two illustrations. The first has to do with Mrs. Hanover several years after her conversion. She had prayed earnestly for her husband to be saved. Then one day he was killed in an automobile accident. She thought God had not answered her prayer. So she became disillusioned with God, and she stopped living for God. She stopped going to church. And 5 years later, she met a man named Roger Sims, who told that the day Mr. Hannibal was killed, that he had picked up Mr. Rogers, who was hitchhiking, when Roger, who was the Christian witness to him about Christ, Mr. Hanover was so convicted that he pulled the car over to the side of the road and he wept and he prayed to receive Jesus as his Lord and his Savior. Hearing this, Mrs. Hanover wept for joy, but at the same time she wept for grief. Joy that her husband had been saved, and grief that she had stopped obeying God and had given in to discouragement. This discouragement. The second has to do with Josh McDowell, who was attending seminary in California. His father went home to be with the Lord. His mother had died, no doubt, earlier. But Josh wasn't sure of her salvation. He became so depressed, thinking that she might be lost. Was she a Christian or not? These are the things that he pondered in his mind. The thought obsessed him so much, so he prayed, Lord, give me an answer so I can get back to normal. I just got to know. It seemed like an impossible request, but 2 days later, Josh was the very person who drove out to the ocean. He walked to the edge of appeared to be alone. There sat on a woman, an old woman, in a lawn chair, fishing. She said to him, "Where's your home? Where are you originally from?" "Michigan," he said. "Union City, as a matter of fact." He said, "But nobody's heard of it. I tell people it's a suburb near Battle Creek." And that's when the old woman said to him, "I had a cousin from there." And she asked him, "Did you know the McDowell family?" Stunned, Josh responded, "Yes, I'm Josh McDowell." "I can't believe it," said the woman. "I'm a cousin to your mother, but I'm a cousin also to you. Do you remember anything at all about my mother's spiritual life?" asked the young man. "Sure. Your mother and I were very young teenagers at the time when a tent revival had come to town. But it was then that both her and I came forth on that night and we accepted Jesus as our Savior." Can I tell you then that God doesn't always answer prayers to our liking or on our timetable, but he does answer the prayers of his children. He may not come when you want him to come, but he'll always show up when you need him most. Our confidence in prayer has everything to do with God's performance in prayer. And it also has to do with God's people in prayer. According to James, Elijah wasn't a perfect man, because James said he was subject to the same passions that afflict all of us. But what I like about what James says here is the fact that he's trying to bring out how God used him despite his weakness to do great things through the prayer of faith. You see, God deals with us on the basis of the here and now. He never holds our confessed past sins against us. That ought to encourage somebody who's listening this morning, because all of us are prone to failure. All of us are prone to stumbling, to slipping up, to falling down. But it's comforting to know that when we get into that place of sin, we can come back to God and have our prayer lives restored by simply repenting of our sins before him. That's the promise of 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of all of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That ought to encourage somebody this morning. If you take the time to look at some of the people in the Bible, and I'm talking about people like Abraham, Moses, Jonah, people like King Hezekiah, you find that they were all men who failed God at one time or another in their life, but yet they were all great men of prayer. I'm grateful that we have a God who invites us to join him in bringing our needs to his attention. Let me say that again. I'm so grateful, brothers and sisters, that you and I have a God who invites us to join with him in prayer as we bring all of our petitions before him and asking God to do this or ask him to do that. We should all be grateful this morning to God that we have a record of his performance. And also because God also has a record of our prayers. But let me add here, as I get ready to close on this Sunday morning, that our prayers should always include praise. Our prayers should always include praise. Praise for his sovereignty. Because God is to be praised for the king that he is. He deserves to be glorified. God should also be praised, not just for his sovereignty, but God should be praised for his power, his abilities, and for the times in which he has demonstrated his power in our lives. If it had not been for the Lord on all of our side, we wouldn't be here where we are this morning. God should be praised. Yes, for his sovereignty, he should be praised for his power. And then God should also be praised for his glory. He demands and he deserves all of the glory in every situation of life. As a matter of fact, God deserves the glory because glory was never intended for us. So God should always get the glory. God should always be glorified on earth as he is in heaven. In other words, our praying is a practice activity that must include acts, A-C-T-S. That's an acrostic that includes adoration. In other words, God must be worshipped. It should always include confession, because our sins must always be dealt with. It should always include, along with adoration, along with confession, it should always include thanksgiving in our hearts. We must always possess a thankful heart when we go before the Lord. And then also it should include supplication. That's because there's always room to tell him what you want. Adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. I don't know how your praying looks when compared to this model here that I've shared with you, but it will never hold up without the letter F in front of it. Let me say that again, because you need to catch this before it runs by you. I don't know how your praying looks when compared to this model, but it will never hold up without the letter F in front of it. We need the letter F because, brothers and sisters, the Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please him. That's the facts. Listen to me good here, Liberty. Great things happen when saved people call on the name of the Lord. But let me put it another way. Great things happen when the people of God call on an omnipotent God. So thank God that you have a record of his performance, and that he has a record of your prayer. Prayer and pains can do anything, because prayer says, I know I can't, but I know the one who actually can. So when you're feeling down, and when friends forsake you, when you can't seem to see your way, do as the songwriter declares, have a little talk with Jesus and tell him all about your troubles, because the songwriter said he will hear your faintest cry, and he'll answer by and by. And when you feel a little prayer wheel turning, know a little fire is burning, because just a little talk with Jesus will make everything all right. The writer of Hebrews 4 verses 15 and 16 says it best for me. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but we have a high priest, oh, brothers and sisters, who for all reasons, no matter what it has been, was at all points tempted just as we have been, but yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain for ourselves mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. And don't forget to add praise to your prayer life. That's what David says in Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. And here's the shout: for the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. He walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the voice that I hear as he and I tarry right there, none other has ever known. I don't know what your prayer life looks like as you listen to this message this morning. But it is my hope and my prayer that you now know you are aware of the key to our victory in prayer. Understand in this part too, you will be challenged to pray. It has everything to do with our frame of mind, how we look at things. Don't look at it through the eyes of the world, but look at it through the eyes of Scripture. That's what gives us our confidence in prayer. We can pray knowing that God will because of what God has said in His Word. That's praying by faith. That's why many times our prayer is amiss, because we're not praying according to faith. If God said it, He's true to His Word. He's not a man that He should lie. God will do as He has promised to do for that very reason. So have that confidence. Get your frame of mind right with God. Know that you will be challenged to pray. Each and every day, we can see it all around us, even right now. We are being challenged more and more in this world that we live in, this society that we live in, this community that we are part of, from the top to the bottom, to pray. You have to pray. We're commanded to pray. We are taught to pray. And we must pray. So brothers and sisters, if you haven't been doing that, then you're really out of tune in your relationship with God. Let's get back in tune with God. Let us dialogue with Him. Let us communicate with Him. Let us talk to Him each and every day. And remember, weak praying begets weak living. The contrast to that is strong praying begets strong living. I don't know which one you would want to have, but I desire strong living. So I need to stay in prayer each and every day. God be praised. We pray that something has been said to help you, to encourage you, to help you not just to get through this week, but every day from here on out. And I believe it starts with prayer. So as we pray, I'm learning to change my thought process when it comes to praying. I'm not in the habit of asking for things because God has just provided without me asking. I desire what the writers in New Testament, and I'm sure Old Testament writers have done the same thing, but I can see it more clearly. When John says, in this sense here, I wish above all things that your soul would prosper and be in good health. That's all I desire. That does it for me right there. Spiritually rich. Everything that I need, I find in Him. That keeps me from looking to man for things that I need. Keeps me from trusting in man, from relying on man, but trusting that God will, for whatever I need, He will supply. That's what the promise, that's the promise of Philippians 4:19. My God will supply every single one of my needs according to His riches in glory. Our problem is that sometimes we don't like how God does what He does, but if you take a good look at it, it was the best thing for you. Right? Best thing for you. So I'm thankful that despite everything I've had to go through, every challenge I've had to face, even related to my health, God has shown Himself to be true. Fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. How much are you willing to put in the prayer? That's what's going to determine your tomorrow and how your tomorrow will be. I'm not telling you that, trouble won't come, but I will tell you this, that the time you put in the prayer will prepare you for what's coming tomorrow, and you'll be able to handle it when it comes. That's what James is trying to teach us here. Gracious God, Father, we thank You. We bless Your name, Father. We love You. We adore You. We magnify You. Give Your name the glory and the praise. We're learning like Paul, oh God, Lord, so many others, when people bring us stuff, as pastors, as preachers, God,
Sometimes there's been the tendency, God, to just want you to do what they want you to do. But God, I'm learning to pray that your will be done. God, that you get the glory in whatever it is, oh God, that we are dealing with, we have to face. Because ultimately, God, you want to be glorified. And so, God, we're praying right now, Lord, that whatever it is that we're going through, individually, as well as a corporate body, that God, you do what's best according to your will. We're not asking for the pain to go away. We're not asking for anything other than, God, you being glorified. So God, have your way in every situation. You already know how much I can bear. You know how much weight I can bear up under. And God, you have made a promise that you will provide us with a way of escape. So God, I thank you for the promise of your word. So I know that in faith, you will already take care of that. But more than anything, oh God, I want you to be glorified. So God, I thank you. The world needs to see us hold up under pressure. The world needs to see us, oh God, endure even when things aren't going our way. So God, I ask that you be glorified. Even as this pandemic does what it does, God, because it did not catch you by surprise. We know that your hand is still on it and you are still in control. So thank you for who you are, your sovereignty, your power, and your glory. God, we thank you right now. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. I know it's Communion Sunday, so for those of you that have, amen, your communions with you. Your bread, which represents the broken body of Christ, and your wine, which represents the shed blood. We ask that you would join with us for this brief moment of just being able to administer to you the Lord's Supper. For those of you and perhaps family members who are not able to, we've always stated since the beginning that you can do it on Saturday. You can do it when your loved one gets home, if you choose to do so, because you learn to through practice what to do on your own. And we're just participating in this partaking of what Paul says we are to do. And it's a commandment from the Lord. And as often as we come together, we do show forth his death until he comes. So if you have what your deacons have already passed out to you, and I ask that you make it available at this time. Amen. And in that 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he talked about the bread. And when he taken the bread, he broke it and said, "Take heed, this is my body, which is broken for you." And they all ate together. Please do so at this time. He took the cup also when he had supped, saying, "This is a New Testament blood. This blood was shed for you and me, right, for the remission of sins." And they all drank together. We don't have any physical vineyards to go to as the disciples did in that day and time, but we do have a hymn, we do have a song. "I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. I know it was the blood for me. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. He's coming back again for me. One day when died upon the cross, I know
for me. He never said a mumbling word. He never said a mumbling word. He never said a mumbling word for me. One day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. I know it was the blood for me.
God bless you. May heaven continue to smile upon you. As we go through yet another week, please be mindful of the addition of our pastor's prayer time, which is every other Saturday at 9, beginning at 9 through 9:30, our next prayer time where we get together will be the 15th and followed by the 29th. I want to give you those 2 days so you can put them in your reminder, put them in your phones as a reminder to help you to join in with us on that morning. All right, this is just another way of God leading us to connect and another way for me to continue to pray for you. Bible says that your request be made known. So share with us so that we may pray along with you, touching and agreeing according to scripture. I want to thank those of you that joined in with us this past Saturday for our first experience in Zoom regarding prayer. And as for those of you that are not joining in or haven't joined in yet with Bible study, I should say, and those, what is those of you that have been, to reach out to others who perhaps you don't see, you don't know, but check with them to make sure that they know how, so that we can get connected in Bible study as well as in prayer. Right, this is something that I'm going to be going after more and more, because it's important for us in these times that we're living in, especially during this pandemic, to stay connected in the manner in which we can, as best as we can. All right, so thank you so much again, and we also ask that you continue to meet your monetary obligation. We don't speak much on it because y'all know how I am regarding that. I don't like standing and talking about money, but I will when I have to. So it's important for us to do our part. And so reach out to those that perhaps may have somehow got a little bit of amnesia and reminded of their obligation as well. Thank you so much. And again, God bless you. Love you. You all take care. Until the Lord will allow us to see one another again, we remain His servant. Love you. Take care.